good evening to everyone. My name is Karan Gunasekaran. As Ashita introduced, I'm from LexisNexis. I'm taking care of IT specialist for India and ASEAN region. To start, begin with a good note for the pre-survey that we have conducted yesterday and the day before yesterday, the winner for that is Mr. Prashant Kumar from Data Semantics. In the meanwhile, we would also request you to fill the poll that has been rooted right now on your poll screen. Let's begin the session. Today's topic is patent analytics, a scientific approach. So we will be seeing why analytics is important and why do we talk about a scientific approach. To begin my session, I'm going to start with a quote from one of our customers, Siemens. Mr. Big Weibel, he is the head of IP. He stated that we don't need many patents, we need the right ones. From our experience, we can understand that many patent departments are still organized in the traditional way and they do not use the analytics tools that are available today. Siemens was the number one filer in European patents for many years in the recent past. However, they changed the strategy right now. They do not concentrate on quantity anymore. They started concentrating on the quality. This shows us how quality is important and why there is a need for it. But how can we determine or measure what is a right patent or a good patent? To understand this, we have a classic scientific approach that is called PAI. We will take you through this slide. In the second slide, we can see there is a size of patent portfolio has been determined in the x-axis. We can see there is a portfolio A and a portfolio B. If you want to look at like company A and company B, you can still look into that perfect perception as well. So by looking at this chart, we may say portfolio A has a lesser patent compared to portfolio B. Does it mean they have the strongest portfolio? No. Counting patent numbers is not going to be an answer, or it is not a best option. Now, when we look at the quality wise, we can see portfolio A looks higher in terms of quality compared to portfolio B. How do we do this? Traditionally, we do an evaluation based on manual intervention, which is very inefficient. It takes lots of money and time, which is not also proven facts. And what will happen when we have millions of patents? Because right now, the industries has been expanded drastically and we have millions of patents to be accounted on a worldwide. Yesterday, it was a traditional industry system where if I'm a car making company, I need to think about the automobile which is needed for the car and I need to know when the assembly can happen. So this is all happened in a nutshell. But today, due to the digitalization, I can see there is a drastic change. So the changes is like interconnected between different industries and it is also interlinked. So a car maker has to understand what 5G is, what is next to 5G. How do I do with AI? How it is going to support me? So due to the ongoing transformations, digital transformations especially, the industry boundaries are getting faded very highly. And the second interesting point is traditional industry players are now competing with the high technology companies and with disruptive startup companies, which are in the same ecosystem. And the third important point, if you're not going to concentrate on improving your traditional industry based on the new inventions, you will not survive in the market for a longer time. In order to retain your business in the market and do a successful industry player, we need to know three things. One, we need to know to whom we should have a joint venture. Do we need to do an acquisition with a new startup who's coming up with a disruptive technology? And the third thing is, we also need to include a new invention or new methodology into our existing system. So these are the three major points the digitalization has come up right now. When we talk about digitalization and the millions of patents, we need to have a new approach which can evaluate the patent quality, right? For that, three major parameters has been described. One is the worldwide patent, or global is a single village right now because it is all connected with in many technology. And the second is it should give a meaningful information. And the third is the foremost interesting point. It should be a very transparent methodology because we cannot simply say the quality is good for them, quality is not good for them. So how do you prove that? You need to have a very transparent method. To show a transparent method, we can do a better decision. I'm going to show you one slide which is going to talk about PAI, and we will also tell you how the PAI calculation is being worked out. PAI is nothing but the patent asset index, and we have patented the business intelligence behind this, and we own this particular concept. PAI is not a black box, or it is not a magical term. It is a proven scientific theory, and it is published in many scientific papers. If you wish to read through what is PAI, please drop your information on the chat box. We will share you the document. To ascertain the PAI, we need to have two major indicators. One is technology relevance, and another one is market coverage. So when I talk about technology relevance, basically, how do we define the technology relevance? How many citations, right? So citations is again not on the quantity side, it should be on the quality side. So to ascertain the quality, we have four major comparators where we can understand whether the citation is good or bad. So in terms of understanding the citation, we use the age. When I say age, if a patent has been 15 years old and it does not attract even a single citation, it means it could be a dead-end technology, or it is a technology which is of no use anymore. Second, patent office practice. Every patent office has their own practice. If I file a patent in US, obviously it will attract many citations because of the US examiners, patent examiners, right? But that's not the case for EPO or Indian patents. So patent office practice is also taken into consideration. And third one is, the major thing is technology field. We cannot compare industry to industry, technology to technology. We need to have a proper calculation over there. So for example, if it is a pharma patent, we need to look into the pharma patent, not on the electronics patent, because electronics patent has a different analysis altogether rather than the pharma patents. So to ascertain the technology relevance, we should have an average value of 1. If you see the average value is less than 1, it means the technology relevance is not up to the mark. If you have a patent where the technology relevance is 1 and the patent scoring is 10, it means it is 10 times more than the average, expected average, and it is far good within compared with the portfolio size. And the second thing is market coverage. So market plays a major role when it comes to patent filing. So when an inventor or applicant files a patent, they need to understand which market they are competing with. Is it US market, or is it India market, or it is Germany? So we consider the patent in a single family member as it is defined by EPO. So for a patent, if it is filed in US, we try to grant 1. And if it is filed in German, we do a calculation of 20%. Because market coverage is valued by GNI of a company, GNI of a country, on compare with US, right? So if a patent is granted in US, it is 1 point. If a patent is granted in US and Germany, it will acquire 1.2. We add the patents where all it gets filed. And if a patent is filed, but it is still pending, then we give a discount of 0.7, thinking that 70% of the patent will get granted in the near future. So in order to get the competitive impact, you need to do a multiplication between the technology relevance and the market coverage. Both should have a decent value in order to derive to the competitive impact. For example, if you have a technology relevance with 10 points and you look into a country which is nowhere related to that particular technology, and you file the patent over there where the market coverage is 0.2, it means the competitive impact doesn't have any impact over here because the market coverage is not up to the mark. When you have a good market, but you are filing a dead-end technology where it is not going to attract any citations, it is again, you are going to spend huge money on that, but then you are not going to get any revenue out of it, right? So that's the reason we need a decent value in terms of technology relevance and the market coverage to get a CI value. What is PAI? Sum of all competitive impact of the entire portfolio is considered to be the PAI, that is Patent Asset Index. Just to know the impact of the Patent Asset Index, I'm just showing, illustrative example here, Swatch Group. So when Swatch Group wanted to do an analysis, they did an analysis on number of patents citing Swatch Group. It's again based on the quantity wise. And they also defined with the filing year in the x-axis. When you look into the chart, you can see there are a number of lines going up and down. Of course, there is no value proportion to that. And you cannot see any particular company which is actually doing good or which is not doing good, right? Because there are, it's just confusing chart. You do the same analysis in this particular tool where by using the PII for patent citing watch, you can see there is a drastic change with one company from the year 2007. If someone can guess it, yes. It is the Apple company, where in 2007, Apple first launched its iPhone. In 2011, there is a rumor that Apple is going to do a wearable device. In 2015, they launched the watch. So when you do a calculation based on the PAI, the differences is so huge and you get the information in click of a button. So this is the difference between traditional way and the latest analytical tool. And right now, Apple is the number one watchmaker in the world. It is not only patent data, they're also making commercial value out of it. So we will see two use cases using this particular tool. The first use case is benchmark analysis. For this particular use case, I'm sorry, it is a descriptive analysis. So for this use case, the concept that I have taken is a search term drone, and I've used it in the search query. And by using the search, I can see the top 10 IPC classification. When I look into the top 10 IPC classification, I can see B64C39 related to the drone technology. And I did an IPC related search where I wanted to see who are the top 10 players who is working on that particular classification, that is B36. Now, by looking into the companies, I can see most of the companies are related to drone technology invention. However, there is one particular company which is nowhere related to drone, but it has a good portfolio size right now. That is Walmart, right? Is it a disruptive technology? Because in the year 2015, Walmart started using a Chinese drone for their logistic purpose. But in 2017, they started owning their own drone technology, and now they are selling their drone technology. So they are using drone inside the Walmart, and they are also selling it. So this is a descriptive technology within the existing traditional player. So descriptive analysis, I just wanted to see how it goes. And this is to understand the Walmart's portfolio. Within the Walmart portfolio, if you see from 2017 onwards, there is a hike, right? So the hike leads to B64C39 IPC classification. So they started in 2017, and in 2020, they are really doing good, and they are doing a tough competition with the other players. The second use case that we are going to see, a benchmark analysis. So in the benchmark, I have taken two examples. One is IBM and Qualcomm. As we have spoken earlier, quality matters a lot than the quantity. Now, if you look into the chart, you can see the quantity is 43 million patents. Patent families are available for IBM, but in terms of Qualcomm, it is like 25.67 patent families. In terms of the revenue, it is 1.214 million USD for IBM, but the quality which is generated by Qualcomm with a small portfolio is 5.644 million USD dollar, right? So the pure number of patent has a little economic meaning and is no appropriate measure for innovative spend. So we should always consider on the quality rather than the quantity. So how do we ascertain the quality and the quantity? So if you use the competitive impact, the chart here, it shows the bubble on the chart, it's nothing but the patent asset index, right? So for patent asset index, initially when Qualcomm started with 8 as a competitive impact, their PAI was very less. Later on, they started concentrating on the quality, not on the quantity. That's why their PAI has been improved, but their portfolio size is still comparatively less to IBM. However, IBM started with a good quantity. The CIE value is also less. And as the days goes, IBM still concentrating only on filing their patents, not on filing the good patents. That's the reason towards the end, we can see the PAI circle is very small for IBM, and they have more than 40,000 family members. So the value in terms of USD that we have seen in the earlier slide. The next is the portfolio overview. So here on the y-axis, we can see active family members. So that's one interesting point. When we do this analysis on our particular tool, we always consider the active family members, not the inactive ones. The reason is when a patent is active, it tries to attract the revenue into the market, and it is also an active technology. If it is inactive, it will never consider into the patent analysis as such. And the x-axis is about increasing competitive impact. So we have the sliced and diced the competitive impact based on the IBM and Qualcomm portfolio. So we can see the top 5 patents which are considered to be gems, and that's related to Qualcomm. So this justifies the previous chart that we have seen. So Qualcomm has started concentrating only on the quality and not on the quantity. However, if you look into IBM, so the competitive impact is slightly lesser there, but still it could be on the average side, but it is not a good sign. So Qualcomm scores more high scoring patents in their own technology. And the next chart is external and internal technology relevance. The idea of this external and internal technology relevance is to understand how many people are using your own technology and how many patents you use it inside your company. For example, if I have a technology A, am I doing a development on that? Am I doing an increment to the invention? If the same technology is being taken by external, then I get to see it on the y-axis. The x-axis will show me the internal technology relevance. So here on the chart, I can see the patent which falls in this abandoned category. It can be abandoned because it doesn't have an internal technology value as well as the external technology value. However, if I see over here where I myself using it, so inside the company, we are using on the same technology, we are working something on that, so it is always good to protect on that. And if you see this particular quadrant where there are bubbles, which is remaining patent lifetime, right? So these bubbles shows how much time it has. It comparatively looks it is a very young patent where the external technology relevance is also good and the internal technology relevance is also good. So it looks like you can keep it and you can also license it if you want. You can also, like, either you keep it or you license it. But if you look at over here, the patents which has been defined, it easy to sell it because you are not using it anymore. So the internal reference for these technology has been stopped. Probably this could be a dead end technology for you, or you would have decided you're not going to concentrate on those technology anymore. But you can see there are external people who are using it. So you can easily sell it to them or you can license it to them. So this chart will help you to identify the licensing. So here we have considered only the patent family members on technology basis. So if you want to look into the industry perspective, or if you want to do the same analysis with different charts, you can also do so. With this, I'm ending with my session.